Friends, welcome to Belong Church. My name is Reverend Jasper Peters, and I'm one of the pastors in our community, and I'm grateful that you're here with us. We are a justice-oriented, diverse, inclusive community that generally meets in downtown Denver, and just like most other folks in this moment, we're meeting you where you are, and we're grateful that you've chosen to be with us this morning. No matter who you are or where you're from, we recognize that you are beloved of God and welcome in this community, and we're grateful that, we get to spend a little bit of time together. I want to name just a couple cool things that are coming up. One, you'll see in the in the comments wherever you're streaming us from, that we would love to stay in touch with you. You can click that note. If you want to get updates from us, know what's going on in our community, know how you can show up, how you can get connected, how you can learn and continue to grow in love and grace as we continue to follow Jesus together. We would love to be in touch with you. We would love for you to be on this journey with us. So definitely check that out. We are continuing our focus on anti-racism work. We had named it initially for a week. We're going to continue that work each day until Juneteenth as we recognize the commemoration and celebration of the end of slavery in our country, and yet recognizing the ways in which its impacts are still felt even today. We also have, all through the month of June, we have our volunteer-a-thon. We have an opportunity to serve where you are. Even if you can't show up in the places you might want to show up, there's still opportunities for us to do good together. So check out the details for that. Let us know how you're serving. Log your hours, and we want to give you updates on how we're doing as a community and if we can reach our overall goal. So we'd love for you to take part in that. And also know, starting on the week of June 21st, we have small groups that are launching. Some of you are already a part of a small group and are locked into that community, and that's great. You're going to learn more about those opportunities through your group and your group leaders. Others, if you're interested in a group, or even perhaps you'd like a group in this moment, but you're not sure about a long-term commitment, we're setting up some pop-up groups that'll only go for about 6 weeks while we focus as a community on messages of hope centered around Adam Hamilton's book, Unafraid. So we would love for you to be a part of that. We'd love for you to be a part of a group, either the group you're already connected to or new groups who are continuing to meet, gathering online, so you're welcome. And we want to make it as easy as possible for you to participate. I say all of that to say, you are welcome in this place, and we're glad to be here with you.
Merciful God, I claim your promise to be with us when two or three are gathered.
You know that each of us has a unique heart and history, and so I can only speak from what I have seen and known and become as one who enjoys the privilege of being born white in the United States.
As I try to understand the ways in which I benefit from that history or deprive others of life and happiness and all the things I take for granted, I pray that you will open my heart, my mind,
my imagination, and my eyes to see this country as it is and not as I want it to be or think that it is.
Even as I utter words with the best of intentions about the poor, those who are dispossessed, those who are disrespected, those who are subtly or overtly treated as less than,
those who fall in that thoughtless, painful category of you people, I feel that I am distancing myself from these others and contributing further to the fissures that divide all of us from each other and you.
Help me, O God, to acknowledge honestly the ways in which white privilege in America is perpetuated, the ways in which racism thrives systematically, and the ways in which our common prayer furthers these divides.
Dear God, I trust your spirit to guide us in our common life and enlighten us to the injustices of white privilege in this country. Make our common prayers occasions for your spirit to break into our hearts and lives,
that we may finally see our world with a glimpse of your love and light. I pray that we may all be healed of our hurts and divisions,
so that we may become agents of the reconciliation and peace that you desire for this world.
This is my prayer.
Amen. Amen.
There's a world that war, sleepless nights, I hear
empathy. Let me hold the door for you. I may have never walked in your shoes, but I can see your souls are worn. Your strength is torn under the weight of a story I have never lived before. Let me hold the door for you. After all you've walked through, it's the least I can do.
As we enter into our time of prayer, we're going to take a moment to pause and lift up the names of many, though not all, of our Black siblings lost at the hands of police in our country. I ask you to read each name aloud in your homes, lifting up our grief and anger at their lives taken, and lifting up their families having lost them, and remembering our responsibility in making change. As we continue in our prayers, as we did last week, we will hold plenty of space for you to share your prayers in the comments section. And I invite you to do so that we may be able to be in prayer with one another this week. You're also always invited to share your prayers through the prayer request form in the newsletter. Let us name those in need of justice. And together we say, Lord, hear our prayer. Let us name those in need of healing. And together we say, Lord, hear our prayer. Let us name those in need of God's presence this week. All of the protesters. And together we say, Lord, hear our prayer. Let us name those with whom we are in celebration. And together we say, Lord, hear our prayer. God, be with us. Be with us in our anger. Be with us in our grief. Be with us in our confusion. Be with us in our empowerment. Be with us in our sadness. Be with us in our boldness. Be with us in the chaos of emotion. Be with us in this moment. Be with us in this moment because, God, we need you. We need you to strengthen us for the work ahead. We need you to forgive us when we fail, because we know we will at times. We need you to open our hearts fuller and fuller until we see all of your children through your eyes. For when we see through your eyes, we begin to imagine a different world, different laws to govern us, different voices at the table, different priorities for our communities, different thoughts arising within each and every one of us, different actions taken by each and every one of us, different worlds created. God, stir in us, move in us, speak to us, and let us be your hands and feet and voice and heart right here, right now. Let it be so. Amen.
Belong Church is committed to giving, serving, and connecting our community and ministry. If you are in need, your church wants to know. Please email us at info@belongchurch.org. The world needs us to be the hands and feet of Christ now more than ever. We ask you to continue to financially support the church as you're able, as we find new ways and continuing ways of being the church. You can visit us at belongchurch.org/give or text 720-552-6707.
Finally, the tables were stolen. Then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and news of him went out through all the surrounding region, and he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. So he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read, and he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovery of the sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." Then he closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down, and the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed upon him. And he began to say to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." So all who bore witness to him and marveled at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth, and they said, "Is this not Joseph's son?" He said to them, "You will surely say this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself. Whatever we have heard done in Capernaum, do also here in your country.'" Then he said, "Assuredly, I say to you, no prophet is acceptable in his own country. But I tell you truly, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a great famine throughout all the land. But to none of them was Elijah sent except to Zephareth, in the region of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow. And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." So all those in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath, and rose up and thrust him out of the city. And they led him to the brow of the hill on which the city was built, that they might throw him down over the cliff. Then passing through the midst of them, he went on his way.
Will you pray with me? Gracious, loving God, Scripture says that you are near to those who are brokenhearted. Oh God, be near to us who are brokenhearted. Those who, with tears in their eyes, still look longingly for freedom, for liberation, for justice, for greater signs of your grace and peace, O God, we pray. Help us to be those who search in your scriptures and find greater truth and meaning and a word for us even now. May the words of my mouth and meditation of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and redeemer. And together we say, amen. We're beginning a series that was not initially a part of our preaching plan for this season, and yet it's an opportunity for us to be honest about the moment that faces us, honest about what we're seeing in the world around us, and honest about what we're feeling in our hearts. So we're beginning a series on liberation. Liberation and liberation theology have long been explored, especially by marginalized communities, communities of color, communities at the margins of society, not allowed to be seen and heard by traditional structures of power, bringing an understanding of God's true priorities in and around the world, in the world around us. It's an opportunity that I hope will challenge you, as I know it will challenge me. And yet I believe that we, that this gathered community will be better and be blessed and have the potential to be a blessing for others if we take seriously the call of the gospel to seek the freedom, to seek the liberation, to seek the well-being of people, even people who are not like us. So as we begin this exploration into this idea of liberation, an obvious question for many would be, well, why aren't we free? Or isn't everyone free? Or is it really the case that there is a lack of freedom, a lack of ability to choose, a lack of self-determination? I would understand that as being a part of freedom. The freedom to live a life at peace, the freedom to better yourself, the freedom to have a place to call home that won't be invaded or disturbed or in which you're not under constant threat of fear. We all want to be free. But the reality is, if we want to be free, we have to tell the truth. And this is what we see Jesus doing. And yes, let's admit that it went really poorly for Jesus. In his hometown, in a place where they were already set and primed to love and appreciate him, they were already ready to celebrate him and remark on how much he had grown and how much he surely and clearly had learned in his travels and whatever time they had been away. They hand him the scroll from Isaiah, and Jesus takes it and he begins to read. He turns specifically to a place and he unfolds for them the vision of Isaiah. The vision that when God's will for humanity, when God's will for earth comes to fruition, that God's messenger will come and say, I have come to set the captives free. I have come to restore sight to the blind. I have come to, for some, turn the world upside down, but for others to turn it right side up. I have come to restore to the dignity and freedom and liberation to all of God's children, to all who long for it, to all who deserve it. This is the vision for Isaiah and Jesus when he goes into his hometown, the place where they were ready to accept him, they were ready to celebrate him. Instead, he tells them about this vision of God for an equitable future that was on a collision course with reality. No, God isn't just bringing justice at the end of the age, not just for them there at the end of all things, but no, justice and peace and grace and love and freedom are breaking through into this reality right now. Jesus pronounces this amazing revolution. And not only does he affirm what Isaiah says, but he says, this is coming true right now before you. And they only got a little mad. If you can call trying to throw your hometown hero off a cliff a little mad, they got a little upset because Jesus challenged their preconceived notions. And perhaps you have experienced how difficult it is to challenge the preconceived notions of people, even people you love. And let's be honest, to be fair, that wasn't their very first response. The first response was, oh my gosh, how cute is he? I imagine this moment in which Jesus holds the tension. He allows these waves of recognition to flow over them, realizing, no, when I'm talking about the people who are perpetuating oppression, I'm talking about you. And I know that you understand yourselves to be on the right side of history. I know that you understand yourselves to be doing all the right things. But I'm not here to do tricks for you. And when I said I've come for those who are forgotten, I'm not just talking about us. Yes, he recognizes that his own people group has their own story of oppression, but then he reaches into the scriptures to say, when I say that I've come to talk about the forgotten, I'm not just talking about us. I'm talking about the sex workers and the lepers and the Gentiles and the Samaritan. I'm talking about all those who have known harm at our hands, at your hands. He invites them to recognize the ways in which they are culpable, that they are responsible for the lack of peace and prosperity and, in fact, freedom in the world around them. He says, I'm here to set everybody free because none of us are free until all of us are free. And if we dare to follow the example of Jesus, that means that we have to begin by telling the truth about what is broken. Speaking truth to power, by the way, it works best if you start at home. Many of us grew up in communities that would send us around the world and spend tens of thousands of dollars on mission projects to go help those people over there with all of their problems. Do me a favor, my friends, look at what is going on around us and realize that the calls for help are coming from inside the house. We don't need to travel halfway a world away to resolve the issues in the world. We can start at home. We can start with ourselves, we can start with our families, with our friends, with the people who are unwilling to recognize the call for liberation as a call for their own liberation. Our country has so long lived with these sins that we no longer recognize them readily. Like frogs in water that wasn't always boiling, we are dying, we are not free. The soul of this country grows more hollow every time we have to explain to someone why compassion matters. We, by the way, my friends, we are not free when death and lies and brokenness can be broadcast in high definition with infinite replays, and yet they're still met with a shrug. We are not free. When we cannot see the truth of who God would have us be, we are not free. This is the challenge that Jesus offered to his hometown. He reminded them that there's no such thing as partial freedom. You cannot participate in the oppression of others and yourself be free. You cannot participate in the oppression of others and yourself be free. You cannot stand to the side and watch horrific things happen and not be understood to be party to that horrific thing. Even if you turn around and close your eyes, you are either part of bringing freedom and hope, part of restoring life and breath, or else you are still upholding the brokenness. Jesus told the truth and they tried to kill him. And he wasn't the last one. We speak about liberation and yet it remains a foreign concept. I want to be free and I want you to be free from threats of violence, from poverty, from sin and death. Jesus wanted his people, his family, the people in his hometown to be free. And he wants all of us to be free too. To be a disciple of Jesus means that we long for freedom in the deepest parts of ourselves, but not just freedom for us. We have to long for freedom for everyone, for all that God calls beloved. We long for freedom for everyone because we understand that none of us are free until all of us are free. Will you pray with me? O God of liberating light, of healing and hope, we ask you to be with us now. More than any other moment that we have seen or lived through, we know that in this moment, O God, we need you. We need your presence, your truth, your life, your love. Empower us, enliven us, dwell in us, empower us to be your church, to be your people who are willing to sacrifice for the sake of liberation, who are willing to tell the hard truths, even if we have to do it at home. Allow us to be those who help to transform this world with your light, your love, your grace, and your peace. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Hey, Belong family, it's me, Uncle Jay. I know you're used to hearing me sing and not talk very much, but I just wanted to name something really quick this week. Belong aspires to be a place of great inclusiveness and diversity, and yet we are not yet at a place where we reflect that desired diversity in our congregation or in our leadership. I understand that I am, in many ways, representative of the status quo and the very systems of privilege that our community and others are working to dismantle. I just wanted to acknowledge that, to let you know I'm working on ways of making our worship more diverse, inclusive, and colorful, and to thank you all for being such a loving, supportive, and challenging community. Please continue to bear with me as I seek ways of cultivating, centering, and amplifying marginalized voices as our community continues to grow. Thank you.
Till it and heaven ring, ring with the heart.
chastening my felt in the days we know.
Friends, thank you for being with us today. We're grateful for the time that we get to spend together. We would love to connect with you closer face-to-face. We have a Zoom gathering right after worship. You can see the links here. We would love to be with you, to connect, to learn more about you, and to have the opportunity to continue to build ourselves up as a community. Keep in mind the small group opportunities. If you didn't have a chance to drop your information, you can still click the link and give us your contact info. We want to make sure that you are aware of everything that's going on in our community. Great opportunities for Volunteer-a-thon, for continuing in the anti-racism work, for all of it. We are grateful for your presence, your work, your commitment, your attention. And we recognize that we, the church, are only able to do what we can do together. As we depart, may I offer this blessing. May you know freedom. In every part of yourself, may you know what it means to be as free as God wants you to be. And may you seek the freedom of those around you with the same passion that you might seek your own. Following after him who has made us and not we ourselves. Go in peace. Amen.
And walk on. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna